First of all, I would like to thank Professor Kotsis for the kind invitation to participate to this very interesting congress. And of course, apologize for not being there with you because of a very full scheduled program. Actually, I have work at the hospital at the evening, and today, tomorrow, to travel to the European Association of Study of Diabetes Congress. Here are my disclosure. Let's start to show the current guidelines and how they are at the moment regarding the management of type 2 diabetes. It is well established that patients with type 2 diabetes have asymptomatic coronary artery disease more than 25% than the non-diabetics. Heart failure is an issue in type 2 diabetes. There is increased risk for hospitalization from heart failure in patients with type 2 diabetes versus those without. Peripheral arterial disease, Professor Liberopoulos discussed such a patient in a previous case. It is very increased in patients with type 2 diabetes than the rest population. And of course, strokes are increased within 5 years of the diagnosis of type 2 diabetes compared with the general population. More interesting is the fact that women and men share different risk regarding the complication as well as the risk of type 2 diabetes. We have found from studies that women are at higher risk of heart failure, higher risk of cardiovascular disease as well as cardiovascular mortality, higher risk of renal insufficiency and failure. They are more untreated and they are less likely to reach treatment goals. On the other hand, men have more complications from diabetic foot and amputations. They are at a higher risk of albuminuria. They have less neuropathic pain and less depression and anxiety and less adherence to the standard treatment. Therefore, we can see it is well known that one size does not fit all, and this is represented to the algorithm of how we treat now at the moment patients with type 2 diabetes. We have to consider different aspects of their life, such as age, cognitive function, social determinants of health, the weight. We will see how the algorithm is manage the weight at the moment, cardiovascular disease, heart failure, and chronic kidney disease, as already said. And of course, liver function as well. And here it is summarized, this slide summarizes the current algorithm according to the ADA, ESD, and of course, of the Hellenic Diabetic Association. It does not differ from this slide. And it, as we can see, it has two major pillars. The first one has to do with the reduction of cardiorenal risk in high risk patients. And the other pillar has to do with the glycemic control as the weight management. Let's start with the first pillar. As we can see, individuals at high risk of cardiovascular disease should receive a GLP-1 receptor agonist or a SGLT2 inhibitor independently of their HbA1c. We see that metformin, that was the queen for about half a century in the treatment of type 2 diabetes, has no longer recommended, is not longer recommended at first line for glycemic control in individuals with atherosclerotic disease or indicators of high risk for atherosclerotic disease, heart failure, and of course, chronic kidney disease. And if we would like to see exactly how the newer antidiabetic agents fits to each patient. If we have a patient with established atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, then GLP-1 receptor agonist or SGLT2 inhibitor is preferred that have shown proven cardiovascular benefit. However, if HbA1c remains elevated, then we have to start an alternative drug for patients that are already on GLP-1 receptor agonist, and we have to add SGLT2 inhibitor and vice versa. As a third option, there is a TZDs for the treatment to achievement glycemic control. Of course, we have to specify that indicators of high risk for cardiovascular diseases, the individual that are above 55 years old, and the presence of more than two additional risk factors such as obesity, hypertension, smoking, dyslipidemia, and of course, albuminuria. And all of this came up after the landmark cardiovascular trials regarding GLP-1 agonists, especially, that shows beneficial effects regarding severe endpoints, as we can see here in a meta-analysis of eight cardiovascular trials. The three-point MACE that includes cardiovascular disease, stroke, and the myocardial infarction is reduced about 14%. Cardiovascular death 13% and all-cause mortality 20%. The reduction of acute myocardial infarction is about 10%. The reduction, as according to the results of this meta-analysis of fatal or not fatal stroke, is about 17%. Of course, the admission for heart failure is reduced about 11%. Therefore, it is obvious that the GLP-1 receptor agonist reduces cardiovascular endpoints in patients with diabetes and high cardiovascular risk, and most likely through a reduction of atherosclerosis-related events. Now, if we have patients with type 2 diabetes and heart failure, then SGLT2 inhibitor with proven heart failure benefits is preferred. And this have come up after many trials with SGLT2 inhibitors that have shown a very beneficial effect regarding the hospitalizations for a heart failure, as we can see here in a meta-analysis regarding the effect of SGLT2 inhibitors in heart failure as well as GLP-1. We can see that SGLT2 inhibitors reduce the risk of hospitalization for heart failure about 32%, a great amount, compared to only 12% for GLP-1 agonists. And finally, we have patients with chronic kidney disease. Then, according to the results of major trials that refer to kidney endpoints, SGLT2 inhibitors with primary evidence inducing of chronic kidney disease progression is preferred. If eGFR, estimated GFR, glomerular filtration rate is above 20 mL per minute, then we have to use a SGLT2 inhibitor to reduce the risk of MACE, heart failure, and of course, kidney outcomes. A GLP-1 receptor agonist with proven cardiovascular benefits can be used to those such patients if SGLT2 inhibitors are not tolerated or contradicted. And of course, the effects of SGLT2 inhibitors were shown with three major clinical trials regarding the kidney outcomes in type 2 diabetes and the nephropathy. The first one was CREDENCE that had to do with patients that had type 2 diabetes. The other two, DAPA-CKD and EBA-KIDNEY, had patients with either type 2 diabetes or without type 2 diabetes, as we will see in the next slides. The major finding of CREDENCE trial was that in patients with type 2 diabetes and kidney disease, the risk of kidney failure and cardiovascular events was lower in the canagliflozin group than in the placebo group, and the reduction of the risk was about 30%. As you can see, the hazard ratio was 0.7. 70. And of course, the further analysis show that the number needed to treat in order to prevent one event over 2.5 years was 22. And then DAPA-CKD clinical trial with dapagliflozin came, and the results show a beneficial effect of dapagliflozin in either subjects with type 2 diabetes or non-diabetics. As we can see here, the reduction of the primary composite outcome that referred to the decline in GFR more than 50%, end-stage kidney disease, or death from kidney or cardiovascular causes was significantly about 40% lower with dapagliflozin than with placebo. We have to notice to emphasize that the result was irrespective of the presence of diabetes. Then the last trial regarded the effect of empagliflozin on primary composite outcome regarding the kidney function show similar results, so a reduction about 30% to the primary composite endpoint. This is was the same. The effect was independently regarding the presence of diabetes or not. And as we can see here, regarding the effect of the GLP-1 receptor agonist on kidney functions, we have some meta-analysis that showed that the composite of coarsened kidney function, kidney replacement therapy, and kidney death, including the development of macroalbuminuria, was reduced about 21% with GLP-1 agonist. And about 14%, we saw a reduction of worsening kidney function. These results came up after the analysis of C major cardiovascular trials with lixisenatide, liraglutide, oral exenatide, dulaglutide, and oral semaglutide. And of course, have to mention the results of the recent trial, the FLOW trial with semaglutide. That is the first trial that with GLP-1 agonists that have as endpoints kidney outcomes. And the results that were presented at the American Diabetes Association Congress in June show a great reduction, about 25% of the composite kidney outcome. And as we can see in this slide, the further analysis of the composite kidney outcome show that semaglutide reduced cardiovascular death, as well the also presence of reduction of eGFR, and these two components resulted in the reduction of the composite kidney component, sorry, composite kidney outcome, as shown in the previous slide. And let's go to the second pillar that has many has we are focusing during the recent years, because it has to do with, of course, glycemic management, but weight management, and that we have new drugs that can that show great reduction of weight in patients with diabetes as well without diabetes. Of course, we know that the greatest glycemic effect is with the treatment of GLP-1 agonists, and of course, insulin, as we will see in the following slides. And of course, the combination of the two agents, GLP-1 agonist and insulin, has the greatest glycemic effect. As we can see here, regarding the reduction of HbA1c, dulaglutide, semaglutide, tirzepatide, and of course, insulin, have a very high efficacy, followed by DPP-4 inhibitors, the sulfonylureas, and as well as TZDs, as shown in this slide. And of course, we have this meta-analysis of Professor Tsapas regarding the effect that the various diabetic agents have on HbA1 reduction, that shows that GLP-1 receptor agonists are the most effective in HbA1c reduction in patients with type 2 diabetes. Semaglutide followed by liraglutide, dulaglutide, basal insulin, and oral semaglutide show the greatest reduction in HbA1c that reaches the 1.5%. And of course, as I have already mentioned, weight management will be the center of the management of patients with type 2 diabetes, since the emphasis of weight is so important, because it's the weight that really determines the progression of diabetes and complication and multimorbidities as well. We have when we have to manage a patient overweighted, we have to set individual goals as to the management of diabetes per se, goals that have to do with lifestyle advice, structured weight management program. We have to consider the medication that patient is on, of course, to consider the new medications that focus on obese patients, as well as the surgery. We have medicines that can reduce, show a great reduction in weight. We have semaglutide and tirzepatide that are very efficient agents regarding the reduction of the weight, as well as dulaglutide and liraglutide. Here we can see the fact that the diabetic agents have on weight management. We know that insulin, TZDs, and sulfonylureas increase weight. Metformin is weight neutral. SGLT2 inhibitors can support weight loss about 1 to 2 kilos, but the major category that is used to reduce the overweight is GLP-1 receptor agonist that lead to intermediate or to very high weight loss. And of course, we are waiting to our country GAP, GLP-1 co-agonists that are very promising with great results from major trials that have been already presented. And here again, from the meta-analysis of Professor Tsapas, we can see that semaglutide, either as an injectable agent or peros, is the most effective in the weight loss in patients with type 2 diabetes, followed by exenatide and liraglutide. As already mentioned, we have to set individual weight management goals, general lifestyle advice. We have not to forget all of these things. We have to intensive evidence-based structured weight management program, and in difficult cases that don't lose weight with all of this lifestyle modification and of course the medication, we have to consider metabolic surgery. And of course, it will be a fault by me wrong to not mention tirzepatide and the effect that has to weight loss. We can see here the results of one of the trials of the program for tirzepatide, the SERPAS-2, with a great loss even in the 15 milligram of tirzepatide that reaches about 15%. We have to see it in clinical practice. We hope to have it here in Greece during October or November. And of course, if nothing can achieve the glycemic targets, then we have to consider adding insulin when HbA1c targets are not met with the strategies and the diabetic medication that we have already mentioned. Of course, we have to maintain cardiorenal protective agents. We have to maintain metformin, SGLT2 inhibitors, GLP-1 receptor agonists to avoid weight gain that usually follows insulin initiation, and of course to limit insulin dose hypoglycemic risk. And finally, we have to consider using combination products of basal insulin with the GLP-1 receptor agonist. Of course, we have not to forget that we have to focus on healthy behavior, nutritional therapy. We have to focus on the technique for the injection. We have to give information regarding hypoglycemia and how to avoid it and to manage it if it happens. And of course, how to weight manage the patient will manage the weight. However, there are still barriers to insulin use. There is the stigma, the perceptions of a late-stage disease, the sense of failure that the patient has when it has to face the daily use of a basal insulin, the loss of independence, the ability to self-manage the disease, fear of injections, fear of hypoglycemia, weight gain, and of course the complexity of the treatment. But the barriers that not focus only on patients, but we still have as physicians barriers to the insulin use, the lack of experience, the lack of knowledge, training, skills, and confidence, lack of support and patient education. Of course, a complexity of regimen titration, financial restrictions, time restriction. Of course, all of this have as a result to delay insulin initiation and to have patients without achievement of glycemic targets. However, insulin is, in my opinion, the diabetic agent that has no limit to the reduction of HbA1c. It has a higher efficacy in glucose lowering, as we can see here, the results of a study that had about 80,000 patients with type 2 diabetes that show if started in a patient with a basal HbA1c of 9.5%, adding basal insulin will reduce further HbA1c by 2.3, great reduction for the achievement of glycemic targets. And of course, we have the digital tools, the new technology that help us, and I believe that they will further help us in the future regarding the management of patients with type 2 diabetes, and especially if they are on insulin treatment with telehealth, smart insulin pen and cups, smart insulin pumps, digital health tools, and of course, continuous glucose monitoring that help us with the glycemic management. As coming to the end of the presentation, we have to mention that the recommended targets in adults with diabetes have to do, of course, with glycemic control, have to do with comorbidities, the presence of cardiovascular disease or cardiorenal disease. But we have to give advice to focus on physical activity, the achievement of the targets of blood pressure, of course, the glycemic targets, the lipid targets, as Professor Liberopoulos told us in the previous presentations. And something, except for physical activity, something new that came up with the recent algorithm was the habits, the daily habits that patient has. But before we go to this, we have to mention that a wide range of physical activities can significantly reduce HbA1c levels from something as simple as breaking a prolonged sitting to high-density interval training. It is very interesting that about 5 to 6 minutes intensity work equates to 4 years greater life expectancy. And if we have to translate it to steps per day, since we all have smartphones, an increase of only 500 steps per day has been associated with 2 to 9 decreased risk of cardiovascular morbidity and all-cause mortality. Regarding the sleep, it has been shown that healthy sleep is a key lifestyle component in the management of patients with type 2 diabetes. Sleep disorders are common in patients with diabetes, affecting the quantity, the quality, and of course, the timing of sleep. They are associated with an increased risk of obesity and impairments in glucose metabolism, and of course, with daytime functioning. Obstructive sleep apnea affects more than half of the people with diabetes. Its severity is associated with blood glucose levels, and sleep quantity is associated with health outcomes like obesity and HbA1c. But in a U-shaped manner, a long sleep quantity, more than 8 hours, as well as short sleep quantity, less than 6 hours, have negative effects. Finally, extending sleep duration of short sleepers can improve insulin sensitivity and reduce energy intake. And as the STINO2 trial have shown, after 21 years of follow-up, the intensive therapy of patients with type 2 diabetes had, as a result, the reduction in overall adjusted mortality about 45%, reduction in macrovascular complication that reaches 50%, and of course, patients gain many years until the first cardiovascular event, and we can see they gain about 8 years, and they gain 8 years longer survival. Therefore, we have to approach our patients in this way, the holistic management as it is proposed by the guidelines. We have, of course, to achieve glycemic goals. We have to prevent complication and optimize quality of life. We have to see cardiorenal protection, choice of that has to do with the choice of glucose-lowering medication, cardiovascular risk factor management, medication, of course, for glycemic management and weight management. And we have to see all of these social and patient factors that have to do with the diabetes structure, education, support, physiological factors, social determinants of health, to avoid therapeutic inertia, to consider the pathophysiology, the underlying pathophysiology mechanism, to have effective practice organization of care, to reduce the risk of hypoglycemia, and of course, to have better monitoring and ongoing review. And all this in order to achieve glycemic targets, and of course, to prolong the survival of our patients and to improve their daily quality of life. And with this picture that was taken before 2 months at Pythagorean at Samos, I would like to thank you for your attention.